The last speech at this session is by Shehzad Amjad Sahib from Phoenix Jamaat. And the title of his speech is Ashab-e-Sufah, Companions of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم.
Respected Chair, honored guests and most beloved members of the Jamaat, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Today, by the grace of Allah, I have the rare opportunity to share with you a glimpse of a special group of people who are to be counted amongst the greatest of the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This group of people were the richest in the love of Allah, His blessed Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the noble quest for knowledge. These humble people were known as Ashab-e-Sufah, or the companions of the bench. Eminent Sahaba of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, such as Abu Huraira, Bilal ibn Rabah, Talha ibn Amr, Al-Sayyid ibn Khalid, Abu Fazin, and Salman al-Farsi, just to name a few. May Allah be pleased with all of them. In the verses of the Holy Quran that I just recited before you, Allah Ta'ala says, "Say, if you love Allah, follow me, the Prophet of Allah, then will Allah forgive you. Then will Allah love you and forgive you your faults, and Allah is most forgiving, merciful." My dear brothers and sisters, it is this love that is at the corner of my topic today. The love that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for his companions, and the perfect love and perfect obedience that these companions show to their master, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, to understand this bond, I turn to a most beautiful phenomena in nature. In the pitch of darkness, when a bright and shiny light appears, we observe that the humble moths are instinctively drawn to it. They show no care or caution for themselves, but race towards the light. And even if the light is emanating from a burning flame, these moths will jump into the flame, and nothing can keep them away from this light. And as the light illuminates, we observe all the beautiful attributes of these moths. My dear brothers, this is the light that Allah sent to this world in the form of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a world engrossed in darkness. The light which shines bright today as it did more than a century ago, and inshallah will continue to till the day of judgment. Let me now briefly take you back to the time when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated from Makkah to Medina. And after the migration, the Holy Prophet commissioned the construction of a mosque next to the place that he settled. This modest mosque came to be known as the Mosque of the Prophet, or Masjid al-Nabawi. Then a shaded area was also erected by the back wall of a masjid on a raised floor. And this type of a structure in the Arabic language is known as sufa. And this is why that quarter of the mosque came to be known as al-sufa. So the sufa was not an enclosed space, but it was open on all three sides with a modest roof. And therefore, because of this structure, it was exposed to all the elements, the extreme heat of the day and the bitter cold of the night. And this is a place where many of the poor companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would occupy themselves. And this is how these companions came to be known as Ashab-e-Sufah, or the companions of the Sufah. However, my brothers, we must keep in mind that these companions chose a life of austerity out of the sheer love of Allah and His Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this was not just out of mere necessity. And many companions, especially of the Ansar, such as Abu Huraira, Ka'b ibn Malik, to name just a few, already had homes in Medina, but they chose to live in the sufah, to be close to their Holy Prophet. The really true essence of their devotion is best described by Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam in Al-Qasida, where Hazur alayhi salam writes, "The wise chose you and true in their faith, they forgot their hearts and homes. They chose you and withdrew from their friends and removed themselves from their kith and kin." The precise number of these companions is not known, but it is estimated from history that this structure could hold up to 300 people at any one given time. And then roughly about 70 people made up its permanent residence. The initial inhabitants of Sufah were the Muhajirun, or the immigrants, who were without any accommodation, but as time passed, the Sufah would also house people from different areas. The famous scholar Abu Nu'aym is one of the very few people that has named the members of Ashab Sufah, and he has listed a total of 51 members. However, since the time is very short, dear brothers, and the heart yearns that we are able to share each and every one of them with you, but I can only speak with you on a few of them today. But as I do, I very humbly request that you listen, reflect on their commitment and devotion to Allah and His beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we turn to any collection of hadith, we are sure to come across the phrase an Abi Hurairata radiyallahu anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which translates, "On the authority of Abu Huraira, Allah be pleased with him, who said, the Messenger of God, may God bless him and grant him peace, said." Through this phrase, millions of Muslims from the early history of Islam to the present have come to be familiar with the name of Hazrat Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the great companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and credited with relating the most number of hadith or the sayings of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a staggering number of more than 5,000. Brothers, consider this number, a monumental fact. And this is at a time when the hadith were committed to memory and orally transmitted from one person to another. And it would be more than 100 years after the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away that these hadith would be committed to writing. Regarding this fact, Hazrat Abu Huraira writes, "You people say that Abu Huraira tells many narrations from Allah's Apostle, and you also wonder why the immigrants and Ansar do not narrate from Allah's Apostle as Abu Huraira does. My immigrant brothers were busy in the market while I used to stick to Allah's Apostle, content with what fills my stomach. So I used to be present when they were absent, and I used to remember when they used to forget. And my Ansari brothers used to be busy with their properties, and I was one of the poor men of Sufah. I used to remember the narrations when they used to forget. No doubt, Allah's Apostle once said, whoever spreads his garment till I have finished my present speech and then gathers it to himself will remember whatever I will say. So I used to spread my colored garment, which I was wearing, till Allah's Apostle had finished his speech, and then I gathered it to my chest, so I did not forget any of the narrations." Another incident from his life shows his deep compassion and love for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once walking through the streets of the markets of Medina, he addressed the people and said, "How feeble are you, O people of Medina? What do you see feeble in us, O Abu Huraira?" they asked. He replied, "The inheritance of the Messenger of God, peace be on him, is being distributed, and you remain here. Won't you go and take your portion?" "Where is this, O Abu Huraira?" they asked. "In the masjid," he replied. So quickly, they left. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, waited until they returned. When they saw him, they said, "O Abu Huraira, we went to the masjid and entered, and we did not see anything being distributed." He replied, Did you not see anyone in the masjid? He asked. Oh yes, we saw some people performing salat, some people reading the Holy Quran, and some people engaged in some discussion regarding what is haram and what is halal. He said, woe unto you, that is the inheritance of Muhammad, may God's blessing and peace be upon him. My brothers, this is true expression of love.
Narae Takbir! Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa! Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa! Narae Takbir!
Another of the companions of the Sufah was Hazrat Abu Dar al-Ghafari. He was one of the Mahajirun and a very early convert to Islam. He embraced Islam at a very young age and is also remembered for his strict piety and opposition to Mawiya during the Caliphate of Hazrat Usman, may Allah be pleased with him. And like his predecessor, many of the hadith of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam are also traced back to Hazrat Abu Dar, may Allah be pleased with him. Hudayfa ibn Yaman, may Allah be pleased with him, also an early convert to Islam, he was a very pious and spiritual person who was very well known for his excellent manners and tremendous fear of Allah. He was appointed by Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu as the governor of Kufa and Madayan and was the foremost military commander in the expansion into Iraq. He also related a considerable number of hadith, particularly those relating to eschatology, which is a branch of theology which deals with the ultimate destiny of humanity. The next is Khabab ibn al-Ard. May Allah be pleased with him. While in Medina, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam openly preached to put an end to injustice and oppression. He also criticized the practice of the rich for accumulating wealth at the expense of the poor and the outcast of society. When Hazrat Khabab, may Allah be pleased with him, heard this message, it was like a powerful light dispelling the ignorance of the darkness of ignorance. He immediately went and listened to these messages directly from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and without any hesitation, he stretched out his hand and said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger and his servant. So this news actually shook the Quraysh, who did not expect that a simple blacksmith who had no clan in Mecca to protect him could show such courage. For this, they subjected him to extreme torture. Ash-Shaabi is reported to have said, Khabab, may Allah be pleased with him, withstood all the horrors of the Quraysh that exposed Khabab withstood all the horrors that the Quraysh exposed him to. And they went so far as to place burning stone on his naked back until his flesh came off, na'uzubillah. It was Khabab who used to come, my brothers, to recite the Holy Quran to Hazrat Umar's sister and brother-in-law. And we are all well aware of the events that led to Hazrat Umar's acceptance of Islam. The next is Shu'ayb ibn Sanan al-Rumi. He was the son of a powerful Arab and was taken and sold into slavery at a very young age. And despite being an Arab, he had a foreign accent as he grew up in Roman lands. Through a miraculous set of events, he came to Mecca and accepted Islam at the hands of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was greatly loved by the Prophet, may peace be upon him, and when Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu suffered from a fatal injury which ultimately ended his life, he instructed that Hazrat Rumi, may Allah be pleased with him, lead the Muslims in prayer till the next Khalifa was appointed. Hazrat Salman al-Farsi, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, another of the great companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Dear brothers, he left a life of privilege to seek true faith and was sold into slavery more than 10 times before he became a Muslim. As MD Muslims, Hazrat Salman al-Farsi, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, holds a very special place in our history. He received the greatest of praises. It was regarding him that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while explaining the word akhirin in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, said that if faith were to go up to the Pleiades, a man from among these would surely find it. This is recorded in Al-Bukhari. Brothers, we are witnesses of the truth of this statement today. As Allah raised Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam, a man of Persian descent, as the promised Messiah and Mahdi, to revive Islam to its pristine form. Among his many services to Islam, it was during the Battle of Khandaq that Hazrat Salman al-Farsi, may Allah be pleased with him, proposed the digging of a ditch to protect the city. Now, this military strategy, which is particular to the Persians, proved pivotal in defeating the forces of the Kuffar. And it was at this time that he recalls, and he says that it is at this time that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam bestowed another honor on this humble one. And he said, Salmanu minna ahl al-bayt. Salman is ours, so consider him as ahl al-bayt. He was an avid preacher and translated a part of the Holy Quran into Persian. And during the Khilafat of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he was appointed as the governor of Madain, which is in present-day Iraq. My dear brothers, to really get a sense of the humility and the humbleness infused into the character of these companions, I will share with you two incidents from this noble Sahabi's life. Hazrat Salman, may Allah be pleased with him, relates that when I was appointed governor of Madain during the Khilafat of Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, I used to receive a large stipend, but I did not wish to receive any compensation for serving the people. So I used to distribute all the money among the poor and needy of the city. And then I would make my living sewing burlap sacks and selling them in the market. He recalls that I was a simple servant before, and the thought never crossed my mind that this should change just because that I have been appointed as the governor of people. My brothers, how beautifully does this statement echo the saying of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, leaders of nations are their servants. He relates another incident, and he says that one day I was passing through the city when a man who was in need of a laborer to carry some goods approached me. And perhaps from the way that I was dressed, he perceived that I was a laborer. In any case, I picked up his merchandise and we proceeded to where he wanted to go. Some people who recognized me immediately informed the merchant that I was the governor of the city and not a laborer. On hearing this, the man became extremely ashamed and started to beg for forgiveness. However, I told him that there was nothing to be ashamed about and that I would still carry his merchandise to wherever he wanted. He kept on insisting for me to stop, but I assured him that this was my duty. And Hazrat Salman recalls, may Allah be pleased with him, people thought at the time that this was a very strange thing, but in my view, it was not. Again, brothers, I have only shared with you a glimpse of the awe-inspiring lives of these companions. Such was their personal example that on one occasion, Abu Sufyan, a bitter persecutor of the Muslim community before he accepted Islam, said in amazement, I have not known anyone who loved any others as much as the companions of Muhammad love him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One should pause here for a moment and reflect upon the magnitude, the pure desire, and absolute obedience of these companions. May Allah be pleased with all of them. They suffered the elements and bear sheer hunger when food was scarce. However, they were ever grateful to God and instead consumed themselves in the remembrance of Allah and focus on the life to come. And these Sahaba understood and perfectly believed that this world is temporary, but the life to come is everlasting. And it is regarding these people, and it is regarding these believers, Allah states in the Holy Quran, and we will try you with something of fear and hunger and loss of wealth and lives and fruit, but give glad tidings to those who patiently persevere, who, when a misfortune overtakes them, say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong, and to whom shall we return? It is these on whom descend blessings from their Lord, and also mercy, and it is these who are rightly guided. the severity of these trials that these companions were made to undergo. And I will relate to you one saying from Hazrat Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, who recalls, "By Allah, except whom none has the right to be worshipped, sometimes I used to sleep on the ground on my stomach because of hunger, and I used to sometimes bind a stone to my belly to relieve hunger." Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam writes, "The hearts of the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were so inspired by the love of God, and they were so affected by the spiritual attention of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, that they sacrificed themselves in the cause of God like sheep and goats. Can anyone show us the followers of any previous prophet who demonstrated such sincerity and devotion?" My brothers, the Ashabi Sufah have left behind a great legacy, and it is said by some to have been adopted by the Ummah that followed in the centuries. It is suggested by some commentators that the Sufis have taken their title Suf from the Ashabi Sufah. But what is certainly clear is that the spirit of these people of the bench, or the companions of the bench, and their complete shunning of fitn is to be found in the actions and words of the great Sufis. Brothers, I now turn to the great love that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for these companions. The Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, could easily be described as the guardian of Ashabi Sufa, and he not only looked after their every need, but was filled with a unique devotion for them. He, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, above anyone else, knew and understood the value of their sacrifice. And this sense of love and devotion are best described in the words of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, "I am closer to the believers than themselves in this world and in the hereafter. And if you like, you can read Allah's statement, the Prophet is closer to the believers than their own selves. So if a true believer dies and leaves behind some property, it will be for his inheritors. And if he leaves behind some debt to be paid or needy offspring, then they should come to me, as I am the guardian of the deceased." A close study of these companions is testament to the fact that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was indeed so conscious about their needs that even the companions themselves were less aware. Regarding their physical well-being, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took great care to look after them and shared whatever came his way. His willingness to share with them whatever was physically available in his house is clear from this event. Once he invited the Ashab to his home for some meal, but all that was available in the home at that time was barley. When the companions entered the home of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "By him in whose hand the soul is the soul of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what you see here is all the food that is here tonight in the home of Muhammad." Even when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received any sadaqat, he would immediately distribute it among the Ashabi Sufa. And similarly, if he received any gift, he would only keep a very small portion and then distribute the rest among his companions. On one occasion, Hazrat Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha heard that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had some prisoners of war and requested that he allot her one to work in the home. And despite Hazrat Fatima being the daughter of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Holy Prophet was very well aware of her and Hazrat Ali's needs in the homes, he was also very aware of how hard Hazrat Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha had to work during the day, as she sometimes came home with blisters on her hands. But still he replied, "Shall I give a servant and leave the Ahl-e Sufa to suffer from hunger? I could not give to you, Ali and Fatima, and leave the Ahl-e Sufa suffering from hunger." And thereupon the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ransomed the prisoners of war and distributed the money among these companions.
Nare takbir, Mohsen-e insaniyat, Mohsen-e insaniyat, Nare takbir.
My brothers, physical needs are one thing, they are sometimes apparent, but our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was even mindful of the psychological and emotional well-being of his companions. Once the brother of Hazrat Abu Huraira came to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and complained that his brother spent all his time at the mosque and that he, the brother himself, had to look after the family business and also provide for his brother. The Holy Prophet gave him a beautiful answer and told him that it is due to the sacrifices of Abu Huraira that Allah has opened the gates of his bounty on you. Similarly, it had become the practice of many of his other companions that they would take some dates, hang them on a rope, and suspend the rope between two pillars of the mosque. And this way, people could come and pick the dates as they wanted. It is recorded that on one occasion, the Holy Prophet ﷺ reprimanded a companion for bringing substandard dates so that the sentiments of his beloved Ashab al-Sufah would not be injured. This was the heart of our beloved Prophet, the Rahmatul Lil Alameen, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers, the examples of Ashab al-Sufah are as important today, if not more so than at the time of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were not people of this world, but they sacrificed everything worldly for the hereafter. They were the great lovers of Allah, and it was this love that drew them towards the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many living today would feel that the example set by the Holy Prophet and his companions are beyond them. However, never has it been more necessary for us to adopt the spirit of their examples and their sacrifice in our daily life than more than today. The temptations which surround us in this world today are so vast that it is incumbent upon us to awaken the same spirit of devotion in our every action, so that we may be accepted in the eyes of Allah. In the end, I'm also reminded of the call of Hazrat Abu Huraira that I just shared with you. Go to the mosque and take your share of the inheritance of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the same message that is being echoed by our beloved Khalifa, Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih Khamis, Ayyallah Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz. May Allah enable us and our future generations to be illumined with the light of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And may we be able to carry the light to the corners of the world, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.